Congratulations, graduates. I consider it a great joy to be with you today, and I must say, I find it quite remarkable to me that as an online student, having never stepped foot on campus until this weekend, I have found a home in the DMU community with a strong allegiance to the university's mission, a deep admiration for the faculty and staff, and immense gratitude for the incredible network of very impressive alumni, which is clearly growing in strength every day. I started my journey at DMU shortly after welcoming our first child. I fondly recall taking a first day of grad school picture, and in the photo you can see that we're holding a handwritten sign that's missing a corner where my sweet baby girl, 3 months old at the time, literally took a bite out of my sign. I assure you she's totally fine. A little over 2 years later, I graduated with our second little girl in my arms, and today I stand before you as a proud mother of not one, not two, but three little girls. Blessed is my husband among women. Among you are represented numerous vocations, states in life, personal circumstances, and I want to acknowledge the husbands, wives, parents, children, religious communities, bishops, and friends that are standing behind the person holding the diploma today. What a privilege. What a privilege it is for all of us to bear witness to what God is doing in you. Completing my master's in psychology here at DMU really opened a door for me in my home diocese of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, as the executive director of the Lord's Center, a Catholic nonprofit agency. Our agency had a rich legacy of serving the church in various ways, but it was clear in this new apostolic age, which we find ourselves, that God was ready to do something new in South Dakota. With the incredible support of my bishop, I had a vision for a ministry that would integrate the best of the psychological sciences with a Catholic vision of the human person in support of human flourishing. Sound familiar? You'll be happy to know that the mission of DMU is alive and well in South Dakota. I've spent the last 3 years of my professional life working to build a team of faithful, passionate, creative, competent, initiating people, and together we have set sail in a new direction. Refusing to compromise on clinical excellence nor the truth of what it means to be human, our agency seeks to serve the people on the prairies of South Dakota through one-on-one counseling, programs dedicated to healing, and presentations on the intersection of God and our very human nature. We work hard to create a beautiful environment where individuals can be deeply seen, known, and loved. I recall learning in my time at DMU that the strongest indicator of positive change in a client's life is the quality of the relationship between them and the therapist. This is the same for mentorship and discipleship. I firmly believe that at the heart of these relationships is being seen, known, loved, witnessed. If you'll permit me, I'd like to use the next few minutes of your life to share a story of this work in the trenches that has forever changed mine. As an offering at the Lord's Center, we host healing retreats throughout the year. The retreat is staffed with our team of mental health counselors, trained spiritual directors, and prayer ministers with the goal of providing a holistic and integrated approach for retreatants to engage in both the spiritual and psychological dynamics around wounds and Jesus's desire to heal. 2 years ago at one of these retreats, I found myself sitting next to a woman at dinner at the opening night. We'll call her Barbara. Have you ever looked at someone and without needing words, seemed to feel their pain? Barbara had a lot of pain. If I were to offer you a bit of a case conceptualization, I would tell you that Barbara was a 60-some-year-old woman who could barely make eye contact and seemed physically unable to smile. Besides the occasional yes or no response when prompted with a question, she said very little. A gray cloud seemed to hover her head, so obvious that I almost wondered if I could just blow it away. The next day, between conferences dedicated to addressing the topics of God's love, wounds, shame, and forgiveness. Retreating spent time meeting with a counselor, visiting the sacraments, talking to a spiritual director, or coming in to pray alongside myself and one of my colleagues. That afternoon, around 4 o'clock, Barbara walked in, along with her stormy gray cloud. As was our custom, we asked her if there was anything specific she would like prayers for that day. After a long pause, I thought surely she was preparing to pour her heart out. After a while, she simply shrugged in defeat and said, "Everything. I can pray for everything." I poured my soul into that prayer, asking God to come in to her heart and work extraordinary miracles, aching for her freedom from the stormy gray cloud that seemed to follow her around. On and on I went, praying the biggest and most eloquent prayers my little heart could pray. And after a while, the more I prayed, the more it became clear. Nothing was happening. A bit defeated, I closed the prayer to indicate the end of our time. At this point, most retreatants would thank us for praying with them and move to exit the room. But not Barbara. Barbara just sat there. 30 seconds passed, then a minute, then two. And I had the distinct notion that we were to be keeping vigil. As we sat in the heavy but not uncomfortable silence, Caravaggio's image of Thomas touching the wounds in Jesus's side came to my mind and took center stage of my thoughts. Another minute passed, and I could no longer keep myself from speaking that image into the room. I shared that the image is one of my favorites because sometimes we're just not ready to let Jesus come and touch our wounds. So he invites us to touch his first. "That resonates with me," Barbara said, taken aback by the number of words that just came out of her mouth. This was like a filibuster for Barbara. I said, "Really?" And she said, "Yeah, I can imagine myself doing that." So with immense tenderness, we asked, "Want us to pray with you while you do that?" "I'd like that," she said. So we began again, but this time no eloquent prayers were prayed. Instead, we stood witness as Jesus entered the room. The next few moments passed as the veil between heaven and earth was pulled back. We would occasionally prompt, "What's he doing now?" And Barbara would describe simply that he was inviting her to touch his side, then his hands, then asking her to stand, and then inviting her to touch the wounds on his head. And in a moment of intimacy beyond this world, he invited her to rest her aching forehead to his. There Barbara stood in a beautiful retreat center surrounded by the cows and cornfields of South Dakota, resting her head against the King of the Universe. There he stood, unseen and unmistakably there. And we were witnesses. The next morning, Barbara walked into the breakfast room, and I honestly had to do a double take. She was wearing a fuchsia sweater and, dare I say, matching lipstick. But more vibrant than her sweater and her matching lipstick was that smile. I can still vividly see her smile as the rest of the retreatants oohed and awed at her radiant glow. She was different, and we were witnesses. As helping professionals in the world, we're often called to be a voice of encouragement, an alternative perspective, or wise counsel, more or less, right? But I think perhaps most powerful is our role as witness. The love is to truly see the other, to witness them, who they are and who they're created to be, to witness another's grief and pain, witness their joys and successes, witness to Christ healing, and moving in his people. There is more to Barbara's story than I will likely ever know, complex in both psychology and spirituality. And you and I will continue to encounter and collect stories that stay with us, shape us, break us, and inspire us. Heaven and earth will continue to dance as our very nature navigates a longing for the infinite. But the world is desperately in need of helpers who can seamlessly integrate the psychological sciences with the very truth of what it means to be human. I firmly believe that through the mission of places like DMU and the Lord's Center and the places you all will serve, the Lord is doing something new. Go and bear witness to it. Thank you.